holiday season and changes in the air in Washington. So what do you get for that former Bush administration official who has everything? One who might also have fired a bunch of U.S. attorneys for political reasons? How about a subpoena? It'll be a total surprise and nobody else is going to give him one. Even if you are not gift-seeking, it is worth knowing that there is a respected prosecutor with subpoena power investigating the suspicious and still not totally explained firing of 9 top prosecutors by the Bush Justice Department 2 years ago. Today, the Washington Post offers details on how aggressive her investigation has become, and it appears that maybe, just maybe, she could get to the bottom of one of the biggest unsolved scandals of the Bush White House. The U.S. attorney story was the scandal that just sort of went away before it concluded. The victim of suddenly faulty White House memories and refusals to testify to tell the whole truth. The story was simple, really. A bunch of U.S. attorneys were unceremoniously canned for reasons whose explanations were thin, contradictory, and sometimes just downright lame, even by Bush administration standards. But there was lots of evidence that politics were the main cause for the firings. These prosecutors were not sufficiently loyal to the cause of Bush and the Republican Party. The story faded after many months of stonewalling from the White House, but in September, a stinging Justice Department report came out, and its findings led Attorney General Michael Mukasey to say this, quote, "The process by which 9 U.S. attorneys were removed in 2006 was haphazard, arbitrary, and unprofessional." But were the firings a crime? And did top White House officials, including Karl Rove and Harriet Myers, order those firings for political reasons? All important questions. Well, meet U.S. Attorney Nora Danahy, excuse me, appointed by Michael Mukasey to investigate all of this and given power to take real action, like issue subpoenas. Today, the Washington Post reports on the velocity and ferocity of Danahy's investigation, indicating that she is as dogged as her admirers said of her when she was first hired. Sources close to the case tell the Post that Danahy is meeting with defense lawyers using her subpoena power and that she has convened a grand jury to determine if anyone should be charged. So, is there actually now a likelihood that the stonewalling will crumble? Bush administration officials will finally get to the bottom of this scandal, to the scandal of politics overriding justice at the Department of Justice. Joining us now is Newsweek's investigative correspondent, Michael Isikoff. Mr. Isikoff, always a pleasure to have you on the show. Thanks for joining us.
Good to be with you.
Mike, there is this one player in this mystery who I'm very interested in, Kyle Sampson. He was Alberto Gonzalez's chief of staff. It seems like if anybody knows why these attorneys were fired and whether the White House was involved, it would be him. What do we know about what investigators might be looking for from him?
Well, Kyle Sampson, of course, he was the chief of staff to Alberto Gonzalez, and he has testified. He's testified before the Congress, and he gave lengthy testimony to Glenn Fine, the Office of Inspector General. We sort of know his account, and of course, on probably the most key question, which is how a number of those U.S. attorneys, and one in particular, David Iglesias, the one from New Mexico, got put on the list to be fired in November of 2006, Kyle Sampson professes not to remember. Although it was his list, he put it together, he presented it to Alberto Gonzalez. He says he can't remember, or that's what he's told Congress under oath, how he came to put Iglesias's name on it. Now, I mentioned Iglesias because that is the one, if there's going to be a prosecutable crime here, it will revolve around the firing of David Iglesias. We know from the OIG report that the New Mexico political operatives were complaining to Karl Rove and the White House about David Iglesias because he wasn't prosecuting voter fraud cases that they thought would give the Republicans an advantage in the 2004 and 2006 elections. We know that Senator Pete Domenici, the Republican senator of New Mexico, had complained when Iglesias declined to commit to bringing an indictment just on the eve of the 2000 election against a prominent Democrat. And we know right after that, right after those complaints to Roe from New Mexico political operatives and the complaints from Domenici, that Iglesias gets put on the list. Why was David Iglesias put on the list? It's probably the key question that Nora Danahy has to answer in this investigation. And in order to get that, she's got what Kyle Sampson has said. He's already testified he can't remember. He doesn't have three things: Karl Rove's testimony, Harriet Meyer's testimony, she was the White House counsel, and an internal White House memo that was done on the reasons for the firings.
Well, what about the Karl Rove and Harriet Meyer's testimony? I mean, thus far, nobody has been able to get them to talk in this investigation. Both of them have now, at least we think, left the employ of the White House, although maybe Karl Rove is back there working on some mysterious Bush legacy project. Can they be compelled to testify?
When he's not on Fox News or writing for Newsweek, by the way, but that's or the Wall Street Journal. That's
are they going to be able to get testimony from them?
Well, very interesting. They invoked executive privilege, saying that the president, they couldn't testify before the Congress because the president would violate the confidence of the advice they gave the president on hiring and firing decisions. But an interesting document, which was called to my attention today by somebody involved in this, which was a letter that the Justice Department had sent to the U.S. Court of Appeals on the separate court case on this that the Congress brought for Karl Rove's testimony. And in that letter, which was actually dated September 30, got no attention at the time, the Justice Department said the counsel to the president, that's Fred Fielding, has informed us, the Justice Department, that if Ms. Dennehy, the special prosecutor, determines that accessed information from the White House would be helpful to assist her review, the White House will provide her with such information. Oh. So they're essentially saying they're not going to claim privilege over key information that that Nora Dennehy may want. So that internal White House counsel memo, according to this letter, Nora Dennehy should get access to it. Harriet Meyers and Karl Rove's testimony, according to this letter, they're not going to claim privilege over information that she determines she needs.
Wow, that could be a very important turning point in this case, if that's the direction it goes. Wow.
It could be. Right. Of course, it will depend a lot on what they say once they testify.
Well, right. Once the information is at hand, then we know why they made such a big deal about keeping that information from them. That's the way it always works.
Right.
Mike Isikoff, investigative correspondent for Newsweek magazine. Thank you for coming on tonight.
Thank you, Rachel.